Yet another QNAP ransomware attack, Google drops FLoC for topics, and the biggest DDoS attack in the history of DDoSes. All that coming up now on ThreatWire. Greetings, I am Shannon Morse, and this is ThreatWire for February 1st, 2022. And this is your summary of the threats to our security, privacy, and internet freedom. A big thank you to BSD and Lou on patreon.com/threatwire. Patrons get early access to the show, free merchandise throughout the year, and a whole lot more. You probably noticed that I have commercials turned off before you watch the show on YouTube, and Patreon is the sole reason this show is funded every single week. We have some really great stories to get into this week, including one that will really affect your security if you use Chrome this week. So on to the first news story. This one has everything to do with QNAP. Now last week, a new series of attacks started to hit QNAP NAS devices that are connected and accessible to the web, encrypting user files, appending .deadbolt, that's the name of the ransomware, to the file extension, and demanding a ransom of 0.03 Bitcoin per user hit, which equals about 1100 USD. The attackers explained this was not personal, but they are targeting QNAP systems because of the quote, inadequate security provided by your vendor. If paid, the decryption key is sent to the user, and multiple users have reported that the decryption key sent to them does indeed work. So far, this has affected about 4,000 or so internet-connected NAS devices that we know of. This is being caused by the Deadbolt ransomware group, and they claim that they are exploiting a zero-day vulnerability within the NAS software. QNAP originally told users that they could bypass the ransom screen and access their admin page with a unique link. The attackers left a message for QNAP as well, demanding 5 bitcoins, which equals an amount of 184,000 USD, for details on the zero-day exploit. And they also demanded 50 bitcoins, totaling 1.85 million USD for a master decryption key and the zero-day information. QNAP started investigating this issue early last week, and they decided to force update NAS devices starting on the 26th to firmware version 5.0.0.1891. They thought that this would protect customers, as that firmware update, which was originally released in December as an auto update, did fix a remote code execution vulnerability that they knew about, but reports have surfaced from users stating that they are still getting hit with the ransomware and encryption lock even with this firmware update, so it's likely the attackers are actually using another vulnerability. Now, to make matters even worse, when applying this automated firmware update, if you're already infected, it deletes the ransomware executable and the ransom screen. So if a user wanted to decrypt their files after paying that ransom, they would not have access to the decryption tool supplied by the attackers. Because of this, a free decryption tool has been created and shared via MCSoft, but you would still need to pay the attackers in order to gain and be granted that decryption key. QNAP has been targeted by several attacks recently, including QLocker, AgeLocker, and eCoreX as well in the last year. Because of this slew of attacks, it is recommended to update to the latest available version, disable port forwarding on your router, and disable UPnP on the QNAP NAS. You can also turn off SSH and Telnet connections, change the system port number and change your passwords, and enable IP and account access protection within the device settings. Now, while the vendor should be doing more to protect their customers, and given the severity of issues with QNAP in the past year, it would be really hard to recommend. This is still a personal attack because it affects the livelihoods and personal data of regular users and businesses that use these devices. It affects users even more so because they are the ones that are paying for it. As of recording, we don't know if QNAP has paid the ransom or if they've fixed this alleged zero day. Big news from Google. The company has decided to replace FLoC with topics. So let's go ahead and break this down. Google has wanted to replace third-party cookies via interest-based advertising, which is IBA for short, for quite some time now. Their first plan of attack was FLoC. Now, FLoC stands for Federated Learning of Cohorts, and this was planned to replace those third-party cookies in the Chrome browser in 2022, but it was later delayed until 2023 for a rollout. FLoC was planned to be a new technology that would offer more anonymization for users while still yielding good conversion rates for publishers. FLoC received a lot of criticism from privacy advocates, including the EFF, because it still shares a summary of recent browsing history with marketers. Vivaldi is a Chromium-based browser, and they shared those same sentiments, saying ad companies could originally only see aspects of a user's personality via third-party cookies, but FLoC would share new information with those same marketers. So a FLoC ID on a user would be accessible to ad companies. If a user was grouped into a FLoC cohort that was relatively small, then it could potentially be used to track individual users. So it kind of defeats the purpose of replacing third-party cookies, because that potential would lead to the same end result. And as such, Google ended the development of FLoC in July of 2021. Now, Google has been working on a replacement, though, which is called Topics. Topics plans to track users anonymously with a new API that would keep privacy intact for users by making it difficult to re-identify users, making recorded data less personally sensitive, and be transparent and easy to understand for users. The browsing history would only be associated for a few weeks on a user device. Their plan is to allow IBA with relevant ads, but advertisers would not know the sites visited. Privacy lead Ben Gilbraith shared technical details on a GitHub post, explaining that Topics will track behavior across a few hundred areas of interest, but these would not include sensitive topics such as race or gender. Whenever a user visits a site with interest-based advertising on it, the Topics API will share a very small portion of the detected areas of interest with advertisers randomly, of which one topic would be selected from the top interests. From a user perspective, you could disable tracking for specific areas of interest, and you could also review topics that have been associated with you. The technical information explains how Google is hoping to fix what FLoC would have failed at. Topics would have more transparency and less digital fingerprinting, especially around sensitive topics. Google is still pushing ahead on removing third-party cookies, but they're still trying to keep existing components of digital advertising. Google is planning to roll out a testing phase on Topics this year. Now, you might be wondering, why haven't they just blocked advertising altogether? And you probably already guessed it, money. Google makes 80% of their revenue from advertising. Alternatively, Mozilla and Safari both block third-party cookies by default in the past few years. I want to say a big shout out to my Hush Puppy perk level patrons for sharing their fur baby photos and for the support. I want to go ahead and get into the last story. So let's finish out with today's episode with my last top story about a huge DDoS attack. Microsoft posted a release last week detailing the rise in DDoS attacks that they have protected their customers against throughout 2021 Q3 and Q4, going into detail on the biggest attack ever seen in history. They also explained in this post that they had detected a rise in attacks that lasted for more than 30 minutes, but they also saw a drop in attacks that lasted less than 30 minutes, from 74% of attacks down to 57% of those attacks. On average, they saw 1,955 attacks per day on Azure customers. Compared to Q1 and Q2 of 2021, the last two quarters saw a 43% increase in attacks, totaling over 350,000 different attacks. Back in November, Microsoft blocked a huge DDoS attack targeting an Azure customer over in Asia. Now, this was the biggest record-breaking and publicly reported DDoS attack ever, amounting 3.47 terabits per second of data with a packet rate of 340 million packets per second. It originated from 10,000 different sources from multiple different countries, including the US, China, South Korea, India, Iran, Taiwan, Indonesia, Russia, a lot more, and the entire thing happened via UDP on port 80 and 443. The attack happened for 15 minutes, but Microsoft mitigated it using their Azure DDoS protection platform. They also noted that two more attacks occurred in December, also targeting Azure customers in Asia that were huge in size. Now, this is bigger than the previously reported attacks on Google, Yandex, and AWS, which used to be the record-breaking attacks. Azure Networking Product Manager Alethea To explained the reason that these hit Asian customers can be contributed to gaming, of all things, with gaming being the hardest hit industry. No surprise, given that the industry is incredibly popular in Asian countries. Financial institutions, media, ISPs, retail, and supply chain industries were also at the top of that list. Wow, that's crazy. Do you want to see more tech videos from me? Check out my YouTube channel. It's youtube.com/Shannon Morse for everything from tech reviews all the way to security tutorials. And with that, do not forget to like and subscribe to Hack5. I'm Shannon Morse, and I'll see you on the internet.